All right, can y'all hear me okay? Let me know how the mic's doing for me. Gonna start on some WebTerm work today. A couple of updates I've been wanting to make to it. Alright, so somebody in the chat, let me know, is this audio working for you? Can you make out my voice? Music levels sound alright? What's up, Francis? Good to see you. So, for sure, one of the first things I want to do is change how commands get loaded. And, thinking the scheme's going to be, currently the settings folder, but we're eventually going to change this to system, I think. But for now it's settings, web term, and then commands. And that'll be the folder that contains all of your different command packages. Currently they're all getting loaded off of a JSON config file, and I think I'd rather just switch that over to a folder scan to make things a little more convenient. So this will affect how you create WebTerm commands, and you'll do it by creating a folder, like, foo is the name of my command, let's say, and then you'll have an index.json there, and an index.js, and that's the minimum requirement. And the nice thing about that is that that means the commands can just be folders on your drive, or they can actually be mounts that you install. So let's mock up the folder structure this will depend on. And then we'll just create an example to work off of. And that was gonna be broken. That's a bug. Calling edit on a file that doesn't exist yet isn't working. So what's new with you, Ferbadil? Every WebTerm command has a type of WebTerm.sh command package, and then you spec out all of your commands. It'd be easier just to pull from an example on that. Alright, so that's pretty much got our package set up. Alright. So now let me get into how the commands get loaded. Right, list programs. Yeah, that's not how we're gonna do this. So we'll do a query against the file system. Looking against the path for settings WebTerm command star. So the query function is a relatively new function I've talked about in the past. It's just a way to basically run, you know, kind of multi-folder queries against the file system. Can't remember if I can do, if I do type directory. That would not match against a mount, so I can't filter by type. Okay. So then we need to filter this down. And d.stat, that is directory. Alright, so this will give us right here. Is that right? Yep, that's the one. So there's our folder showing up inside the query. So the query's working correct. Now, previously, we had... Alright, so we need to go from this object shape to this object shape. Also gonna need to figure out how to inject the standard commands into this listing, but let's not worry about that yet. So that's pretty straightforward. The just need to iterate through each of the packages, read their index.json, attach that as a manifest object, and we actually should be done. So let's do that. And for the sake of simplicity, I'm going to just concatenate the current implementation and the new one just to see if they merge together elegantly. So let's turn this into a chain. You filter and then you map. No, I can't do it that way. I need to do it like this for the package. Package dot manifest equals weight, and I'm gonna do. Nope, can't do it this way. Navigator dot file system dot read file. And we'll use the package path plus index.json. Alright, what is this thing complaining about? That's a reserved word. Just kidding, we'll use PKG then. Alright, if something goes wrong, we need to append an error. There we go. Concatenate them together and see what we get. If it's working, actually, we should get my test command loaded right now. Yeah, wow, sweet. All right. So now we have packages getting loaded from the file system, which is good. Should make it easier for people to just build a couple of custom commands, which is nice. And then let's make sure that it works as a mount as well. So let's recreate our example. Why don't we copy over the JS implementation as well? Alright, and now let's just mount. Let's see. Should be pretty straightforward. I just need to create a new link. And that is broken. Sweet. Alright, so that's not gonna work, so let's use the command line. Oh, do I have a command line for that yet? I don't think I do. Alright, no command line mounting command yet. Stupid. Alright then, I'll use a shell. File system that mounts to settings web term command example 2, except I just mounted index.json. Hopefully that works. Okay, that worked. All right, so now we should have test 2. All right, great. So both mounts and both mounts and folders work now as ways to install new commands. That's good. So now I suppose the next step should be to go ahead and round out this implementation here. Alright, list programs is going away. So let's take a look at how that was implemented. Programs API, list programs, and I'm guessing that this programs listing injects the standard commands at some point. Yep, that's how I do it. Alright, I need another way to inject standard commands. I guess I can. Let's see, I guess I could probably read it using fetch. Yeah, alright, here's what I'm gonna try. The standard commands get served off of a built-in address, beaker:\standard commands, and what I want to get is the manifest. I want to be able to pull that from the actual files, so I think what I can do is this. Turn that into an array, and then I think I can do this using fetch. Let's see what happens. Did that just work? I think that just worked. Make sure it's running the most recent code. Yeah, it worked. Man, I'm batting 1,000 right now. That's great. Never expected anything to work. Alright, so that'll now be how we set up the default, and then we'll do user packages, and that's how we'll add them. Alright. That's gonna be a short live stream if I keep on getting things done that quickly. Alright, so test and test two work. Great. Okay, so that's good. That'll make it a lot easier for people to author their terminal commands. Alright, what next? Let's see. So, I've definitely been thinking about adding a couple of new commands to, let's commit the work I just did there. Not that. I guess it's all in user land. WebTerm. Yeah, all right there. Alright, one thing that is not implemented yet is there's no way to just log out while the command is operating, so currently WebTerm commands can only hit the, they can only output anything when they return a value, and it would be nice if they could actually dump things out as they execute, so I'm thinking let's add that. But I'll be right back. Take a look at adding that command. So every terminal API gets added for the WebTerm environment. Currently it has three mechanisms, a way to get the current working directory, a way to set the current working directory, and a way to resolve paths off the current working directory. So, I'm thinking we need to add like a log method, and we gotta decide how we want that to work. I'm thinking I'm actually gonna keep console.log separate and dumping into the console, as you can see that I've been doing as I debug. So when you're working on a WebTerm command, you will still be able to open up the dev tools and see what the hell's going on, which is useful. So why don't we I should call it log, terminal.log, terminal.out. Maybe terminal.out. And And I guess we gotta decide if we wanna have, like, log levels. I'm thinking not. Let's just do a straight output. Yeah, let's just do a straight output. Also gotta decide if we wanna make it output HTML. Now remind me, how are we doing that? Are we just trusting HTML that comes out right now? History. Output. Yeah, we're just trusting HTML output right now. Yeah, terminal commands are currently trusted. They actually have complete access to the browser. All the internals and everything, which means be careful when you install people's terminal commands, but that's the fastest way to get this out, and then we'll get a sandbox version in the future. Yeah, I'm just gonna trust the output. And let's see. I guess the way I gotta do this is the command history has, it's gotta append to the current output of a command. Oh no, the output history is a structure. Oh wow, this will be interesting. Let's see. The way I designed this is not amenable to what I'm trying to do. Brother. Let's just try something and see how it goes. Need to massage those arguments in case they have any JSON in them, so or just objects. But let's start with that. So let's head over to my test command. A couple of terminal dat outs in there. In there, so let's find out. Probably is not gonna do what I want it to. And then we'll do terminal dot out of foobar. Alright, save that. Let's reload the terminal. Alright. That was interesting. That just dumped all over the place. Alright, so we need a new line at the end of it. Well, that's interesting. Put it in the wrong spot. What are we not respecting? Set to whitespace pre, so this should work. What's happening here? Let's add. Wow, Why are my new lines not being respected? Huh. Maybe because it's not... Yeah, I bet I know why. It's probably because it's not being output into the right area. Yeah. Alright, interesting. Yeah, let's see what happens when I click that link. That's not right. So I'll need to fix that as well. But first, let's figure out what's going on with the output placement. It ought to be getting basically folded into the output section of, so like this is up above the command invocation rendering and it needs to be below, so I need to fix that. Which probably means I need to either modify how output is rendered or I need to make my output command a little smarter. So let's keep a running to-do list for ourselves here. We need to render objects. We need to fix the placement of the output. Need to handle links correctly, and we need to what else? Make sure that the rendering is, yeah, that'll be part of the fixing and placement. So those are our to-dos. Alright, we'll start with fixing the placement on the output. So, let's look at how I do this. Whenever I append output, I add a place in the history that the command will dump into, and I do that because if your command is asynchronous, it actually shows a spinner. It's for an async function, so... There's that spinner. So, I need to set it up so that any terminal.out routes to the correct, routes to that, basically that output that I created for it, which means I kind of need to track who's doing the terminal.out. This may be a little tricky. It would be really sweet if the terminal output would stay in the command. Maybe the whole spinner idea is a bad idea. I don't know. I mean, the nice thing about having the spinner going like that is that you can keep on doing things while some command is finishing. So asynchronous work doesn't stop you from inputting anything, which is pretty handy. On the flip side, if you do it like this, and while that spinner's running, you could have more output kind of building next to that spinner, and that's like, it's gonna be moving your cursor around and stuff. But I don't know if I care about that. The real problem is, I don't have any way to track which command is calling terminal.out, so if there's an asynchronous command that's running, and then another one that's running, which one's the one that I need to be dumping into? Because I don't have that information. Wow, that scroll bar is ugly as hell, I gotta fix that. Let's add that to the to-do list. Tell me where- This is tricky. Let's see. I could bind the this object on the commands. And instead of using a global terminal object, you just use this. That feels really hacky though. But that would certainly help me track which command is trying to output. Oh boy, that's a pickle. But I don't hate it. I might just do that. Alright, let's do that. Alright, so here's how we're gonna do this. When a command is executed, which happens right here, instead of just calling it like we're doing here, we're actually gonna use .call. We're gonna bind this object. All right. So. To do this, we need to so that, let's see if that's working correctly by just passing that straight in as is. And we'll just change all these terminal dot outs to this dot out. Yeah, that worked. So then, the out method needs to actually be built custom each time. So we need the closure to capture which output we're dumping into. And then we've got an output object somewhere, don't we? Ah, of course. Let's see how append output is built. So I should be able to capture the index of the output.
Okay. Slightly, still got some things to work on.
Let's see. Interesting. YouTube is telling me that they're detecting the copyrighted audio, and they might block my stream. So I guess I gotta quit the music. Let's see if that message goes away. No more music. That's no fun. Yep, you know, people are on. It doesn't look like I'm blocked yet. All right. So now I can track which command invocation is trying to output information, which is the first step that I needed to start to fix my output positioning. Now I need a way to... The way it's designed currently is that the output for a command is generated after the command is invocated, and I actually need to invert that so that the output is created and has its position, so then any updates... Yeah, alright, let's see here. In fact, my entire approach here is probably going to need to be changed. Yeah. Don't you hate it when some assumption changes and suddenly you have to really rework the whole thing? Let's see. What's a good way to solve this? Yeah, because the problem is append output is used in a number of places. Not just for command invocations, so if I change it for this, I have to change it, like, all over the place. Which isn't the worst in the world, but it's a bigger change than I'd like to do. Also need to change the way this works so that output can accumulate into the buffer. This is a little tricky. Could also just get rid of the spinner behavior. To get rid of the spinner behavior, should actually solve my problem. Not really. So, fix this. I guess what I need to do is I need to break down, if I broke down the way that the output functions, yeah, that might be what I need to do. I need to break it down into multiple pieces, because one of the things that happens right now is that basically every output
includes a header, which is this information right here, and then the actual output, which is that right there. And that's output through one command based on an old assumption. So basically I need to make it so that this outputs separately from this, and then we wouldn't really have this problem exactly. So let's start with that. So let's start by creating a generic output command. And this generic output command will not have the header. We will want to create the place in history. We will want this, where we put in a spinner. Yeah, that looks more or less fine. Then CWD. Don't need that. Don't need this. Okay, and then we need let's see what happens if I break it up like this. Eval prompt. I'm going to anymore. Let's get rid of that. And the fan is spinning up, and the application froze. Love that. Sort of worked. Sort of almost making progress. Okay, so breaking that up worked. Let's change append. Let's get rid of append output. Let's change that to just, that should be just output. Okay, and then and output gets used for that and that. Okay. Okay, done with that. Append output now gets used just for append error, and this is easy to fix up. We just do this dot output header and cwd and command, and then just change this to output. Okay, and append output should just be done. Okay, so we'll remove that. And let's change append error to output error. Okay, and then let's move this up here. Make it not async. I don't know if this needs to be async either. Does it? Yeah, it does. Okay. All right, making progress. So then let's change up some styling here. Entries used to be broken up into the header and the content, but now those are different outputs, so they're different entries. And that margin bottom is no good anyway, so we're going to take that and move it up and make it a margin top. We're going to get rid of entry. We'll just make that header and then make this entry. Okay. And so then this becomes this. And this becomes this. This becomes just a header. Okay. See how that looks? A little wonky. Right. That makes sense. Okay. Let's see. What's the right way to deal with that? I guess if I put a margin top on the input, that would solve it. Let's see, prompt. There we go. And the live help is persisting beyond what it should because I had that. The tab completion options needs to be run after eval prompt. And so that means like right here. Okay, good. Okay, that's all looking fine. Now let's see what's going on with test, because that's erroring, can't push on undefined. I'm guessing that's because that this is incorrectly bound, so let's turn that into a arrow function, which will fix that. Okay. Well, interesting. We may be close to done here. Problems, but nothing I can't fix. The terminal.out is currently going to the wrong that this dot out is currently not tracking with the right one. It's all dumping into the bottom. And then the result is dumping out in the wrong spot too. Pretty solvable. Let's see. So first, let's change this to div with the class of entry. Okay, good. That fixes that. And then let's get the output positioning correct. So the way to do that, let's see, what is the way to do that? Every time, so like the naive solution will have problems, but let's start with the naive solution. So the naive solution is we're going to splice in each new value, which is way off. Wasn't even naive, I was just wrong. Let's see. It's wrong because the output header needs to be accounted for. Yeah, there we go. And it's still wrong because it needs to, yeah, it's reverse order, so that index needs to increment every time. This is still going to be wrong at the end of the day. Yeah, so that solves that problem, but yeah, so as predicted, the offsets have to actually update across the fucking thing. So I need to like group together all the output for a given command so that I can properly append it. Oh boy. So one way I could do this is I can insert a buffer. Okay, I got it. So we're gonna take this part right here and move it up to right here. And then we are going to insert into the output history an empty array. Yep. We're going to mark that as our output index. Then every time this thing outputs, we're going to push onto that array. And then we'll... That might actually be all we have to do. Hey, that's it. Got it. Sweet. Let's show a little more asynchrony to demonstrate for sure that this works. Yeah, totally works. Sweet. Kind of fun. right, that's pretty cool. I dig that. Let me get this on the break. Okay, so now we got that working. Let's go back to our to-do list. Fix the placement of the output. All right, three more items to go. So let's get rid of that and this. Let's also jump over to my standard commands and get rid of all the terminal calls. Of course, I use this utility function all over the place that will not inherit the context, which is why you know, you don't want to use this usually, but
don't really have a choice.
You know, I'm not gonna try to say your name, sorry, but thanks for saying it's a cool stream. And then bash RC, what does WebTerm do? So this project I'm working on is called the Beaker Browser, and it is a web browser with a peer-to-peer file system integrated into it, and so it's actually, because of that, it's able to run its own applications, and the entire browser is almost more like an operating system. And WebTerm is a built-in command line tool for interacting with the file system and running commands. So what I'm working on right now is basically the terminal environment. Earlier I updated how you can create custom commands, and now I am working on the environment so that you can output, you know, into the terminal while the command is running. Because previously the way it would work is every command is just a JavaScript function that gets called, and the return value gets put into the terminal output. And sometimes you want to be able to output stuff as the thing is executing. And so I'm adding that mechanism for the thing to do that, which required a couple of rewrites. And so far, so good. But one of the changes I had to make is the APIs for outputting things is given to the functions, the terminal functions, and now I'm having to update that, the code that uses it. So resolve parse needs to be updated. All right. Okay, so that's that. So now we need to render objects. And I have logic for that actually right here. So if I generalize this, I can reuse it. So I'm going to do that. All to here, and I change this to this dot output, additional output. Okay, that generalization didn't quite go the way I wanted it to. Didn't generalize it perfectly. So, unlike the normal output, this command needs to allow multiple things, and yeah, it's just not going to generalize that well. I'm going to keep the generalization because you never know, but it's too bad. It's definitely nice to be able to make the asynchronous thing, because like... this should be interesting. Should have seen another spinner. Oh well. Don't think I'm going to do that anyway. This dot out does not need to support promises, so I'm not going to bother. So instead, I'm going to take... what parts of this logic do I want? Really just this. So, let's see. This really isn't that hard to make work the way I want. I just need to... do args equals args dot map. Okay, so that's pretty straightforward. So now if you dump an object, it'll just JSONify it, which I'm fine with. Not the best, but not the worst. It'd be, you know, someday we could make it so that it does a kind of a explorable JavaScript object, you know, thing like the DevTools does, but we don't need that yet. All right. Next up, let's handle anchor links correctly. So, have I not? Yeah, so, okay. So I've got an event listener for all clicks. And basically what we need to do is we need to check, let's pull in a DOM helper here called find parent. Need to check if it's a click on a link, and if it is, we need to intercept it and handle it in a custom fashion. So, e.target, and how is find parent defined? Yeah, I gotta write a custom test function, yield.tag name. Alright, so if it's an anchor, then we prevent the default behavior, and we're just going to do beaker.browser.openurl. Hmm. Why isn't that working? What is going on here? Why would this happen? That click really ought to be getting intercepted. Is it possible? Let's take this logic and move it right here. Nope, that's not it. Click events are getting registered. Maybe my test is not working correctly. So let's just prevent default behavior no matter what. Something is just going wrong with the... Oh, I'm not getting any insight into the click path. Man, sometimes web components are a real pain in the... You know what? Let's see. Let's see if there's something I can work with here. We got the path might be our answer. Yeah, the path is our answer. Okay. Yeah, if I just use path 0, that'll work. Okay, now link click should do what you'd expect. There we go. Probably need to try to intercept forum posts as well, but I'm gonna worry about that later. It's not a hostile environment, so, or it's, we expect that all code is trusted for now. All right, so that's link clicks. We're moving right along. This. So let's see. Okay, good. So anchors are handled correctly. One last task. Let's hide that side, scroll bar. I don't remember how to do this, so I'm going to have to search for it. I
think it's a WebKit directive. Yeah, there it is. Come back here. Not hidden. You're supposed to be hidden. What's going on, buddy? Who is it that's scrolling? Is it the... Okay. So that's right. Maybe I need to put it on the host so that it can work. It did work. Okay, there we go. Oh, come on. Yeah, all right. Scroll bar is now hidden, which is good, because that was ugly. All right, and that was my batch of to-dos on this little sprint, so it's time to commit. Okay, that's good. What else did I want to get done? I was thinking about possibly... Yeah, I mean, that's one thing I could do. Package names are not exactly useful. Yeah, I gotta fix that. Let's fix that real quick. So the packages track their URL, and the URLs got a little less helpful when I switched how URLs are done. So, you know, I don't know if it should overflow to the right like that. Probably needs to wrap. So, output entry should be what, pre-line maybe? Yeah. Okay, so that's good. Still having fun with my test function there. You know, one thing that might be fun, just as a little side thing, let's do something that interacts with the social app. So this social app is something that we're working on right now that I might actually get into later on the stream, because I got a lot of performance work to do on it. But just for kicks, let's add a feed listing command. So, the way that the social network operates, it's all entirely off of the file system. And this file system hyperdrive is a compositional network typer, compositional networked file system, which means that you basically mount other people's
networked drives onto your drive, and as a result, you can query your file system and get information by yourself and other people. And it works a little something like this. So let's do let post equals await navigator.filesystem.query. And we're gonna, is it order or sort? Let's say sort by ctime reverse true. And our query is going to be our profile feed star, and then our profile friends star feed star. And let's just start by returning that and seeing what it looks like. Let's start out. Let's put a limit on there of 10, and let's give it a shot. Sweet. All right, that's the data. Now we just need to make it look nicer. The way we do that is we attach a toHTML function to the output. And we do something like return post.map p.drive.title. Oh, and we need to read the actual content. Join those together with a new line. And why don't we make the name of the author bold? See how that did. Cool. Now let's read the actual posts. Now we'll do it like this. We'll do them all at once. Post.map async post post.content equals await navigator.filesystem.readfile post.path, and then we just go to here and do post.content, and you know, if we don't escape that, that becomes an attack vector. That just kind of occurred to me. We need to figure that out. It's taking longer than it should. Did it break? It broke. Shouldn't that have output? All right. Sweet. Now I got a little feed program in my web term. Not too bad. Let's get a little more HTML action in there. Let's put an HR between each of them. I guess one thing that would be pretty wise would be to spend half a second figuring out how to handle escaping. Also, you know what would be fun is if they actually output as they went. I'm just gonna have some fun. So now they should, yep, which is way cooler. Always gotta do the cool thing. Don't wanna do the not cool thing. I dig that. What happens if I put an H1 in there? I don't know if I've styled them yet, so this will probably just be really big. Sweet. I love it. Yeah, totally. Totally worth it. And shoot, if we're doing stuff like that, what if I made this an H3? And then this a paragraph. Yeah, that's pretty sweet. Command line social networking, who doesn't like that, right? It'll be even better when I have real posts from real people. Alright, so we should think about how to deal with escaping content because this is not safe. And let's see. A template string would be one good way to do that, but so I could just stick a global on the window where it's like something like this. Could do that. Could definitely do that. Don't hate that. Let's try it. Internally, I actually use lit HTML. And that's what this will be. So now if you want to output HTML, you use the lit HTML construct, which I think is pretty smart. And so then the out method needs to not do this. Interesting. Let's see how this goes. That's interesting. Did it? Huh. That's interesting. Oh, that's why. Well, that is safer. So I think I'm going to roll that. Even though we're throwing in a new global dependency. YOLO. Alright. So the one thing that's not right is two arguments are butting up right against each other and they need to have a space between them. So I guess basically, the best way to do that is to just add spaces. So, oh man. Basically, I want to insert a space element in between every element. Boy. So it's like doing a join on... It's like doing the join, but not. So I guess the way to... Here's how I'm going to do this. Mutating an array while you iterate over it is always a pain. Maybe the best way to do this would just be to create another array. That. So probably we should make the return values depend on that HTML object too. Safety, which means I just need to get rid of unsafe HTML all over the place. Yeah, just never use it. So let's start with the help command. We gotta update that. See, here I was escaping all of the output because I wasn't using the smart solution. Thanks, Gemma. Okay. What happened to my padding? Is the pad end not getting respected anymore? It might not be. Yeah, that would make some amount of sense, actually. I guess. Let's go. Yep, so this... So I just want pre-wrap, maybe. There we go. Okay, now I need to update my standard commands so that they use the HTML global.
Brother. All right. Right, I even had an escape method here. Alright, let's see if I broke anything. Okay. I broke tab completion. Oh no. I have to work on that. Tab completion, though. We'll get to that in a second. All right, what's going on with the tab completion? No errors. Not sure if I'm happy about that or sad. Let's see. So let's see if it's even running. It's not broken. It just didn't have anything to complete against. Right. Huh, I could probably improve that. Let's double check this. Yeah, all right. It's working, it's just... All right, what next? Let's see, was there anything else I wanted to do on the terminal today, or should I move on to something else? Oh, yeah. I should fix those package names. Alright. So...
Something broke. What broke? Maybe changing the package name wasn't a good idea. Probably because the packages are addressed by... Let's see. Yeah, that's why. Need to amend that commit. Let's see, so load commands. I'm trying to think if I had any other priorities for the web terminal, but that kind of covered it. It is super fun running multiple commands and having them run async like that. That was worth the work for sure. Let's just test my possibility for HTML injection. This should not render as HTML. Okay, and so let's try it. Good. No injections. All right, well, I think I'm going to call it on that, because I could use a break, and also new season of The Expanse dropped, and that is really good. So I think I'm going to go take a break and watch some more of The Expanse. Thanks for tuning in, everybody.
Might try to get another dev diary out tomorrow, talking about what I'm doing with Beaker.network. I guess I'll just kind of stroll through this real fast while I'm here, though. This is our sort of main application that is your entryway into the network. It's a pretty obvious Twitter clone. Yeah, so as I click around through it, you'll notice performance is not exactly perfect yet by any stretch. This is all test data that I generated, and a lot of spinners that take way, way, way too long to resolve. Look how long it takes for the likes and the comments counts are loading, done. And so we're in the process of figuring out what's up with the performance on this thing, which is no surprise. It's not like we started to build it and then went, oh my gosh, the whole thing performs terribly. But the it's an interesting process. This is maybe the third, probably the third peer-to-peer Twitter that I've ever made. The first one was Secure Scuttlebutt. The second one was called Fritter, and that was on Beaker and Dat. That was maybe a year and a half ago. And so this is the third time around, and performance is definitely tricky on a peer-to-peer system like this. What you really want to be able to do is browse around the entire kind of global network and get information from everybody's personal, drives that represents them really fast. And so doing that is a little bit of a trick. You can use pre-computed indexes, but I'm trying to avoid using indexes as much as I can so that I'm just reading off the canonical data, no secondary indexing. And that's the tricky part. Making steady progress here. We'll see how it goes. So, for the dev diary, I might do a dive into how this works. But one of the other interesting things about this is that all the code is front-end here. So, this is a self-contained, single-page application. There's no back-end whatsoever. If I jump into the code here... Basically, the back end is all wrapped up in this file right here. The UWG file, which stands for Unwalled Garden, which is our set of standards that are built on top of the hyperdrive grid. And if I want to list my feed, this is my feed list function. It runs this query. Constructs this query and then runs it against the file system and reads all the files. If I want to list all the, if I want to tabulate the thread of comments, here's that right here. So pretty simple code, to be honest. I've written this stuff three times now, so I know what what's good and what's bad. This is getting pretty good. And so if we can get the performance up to par, I'll be pretty happy. But one day at a time on that. All right, faster than I was thinking. Some of it's my code, some of it's the hyperdrive engine. It's just got some stuff it's working through, but one day at a time. And hopefully not too much longer, because we're trying to get this thing out. Anyway, thanks for tuning in, everybody. Y'all have a real good Sunday, and I'll catch you around.